So, hello students. So we begin our lecture today, continuing with the pointer arithmetic. Hopefully your Dropbox is synced with the WhatsApp address. So for today again, let me share my screen. Share. Okay. And then Alt F9. So in your Dropbox, just click on open folder, and in the open folder, we will have for June 2 today, right? Wednesday, June 2. And then we just select the folder, right? So we have few programs here. Let's see how many we complete today, or else we do some of the string programs for tomorrow. String programs are usually very easy, right? Many inbuilt functions are there, but we need to just look at some concepts. Okay, so the first program that we'll be doing today is pointer underscore 10 underscore dot 1 dot c, right? So continuing with the pointer manipulation, in this basically we look at what are double pointers, right? So first let me just show you an image, right? So what is double pointer? So when we say a single pointer, right? So when we declare something like integer star ptr1, right? So how many stars are there? There is only one star. So we say this as a single pointer. Let me show you this on a notebook also. So today is 2nd June 2021. Okay, so whenever we have, let's say, integer number is equal to 50, right? And then we write integer star ptr is equal to ampersand num, right? So if you see how many stars we have just a one star, right? So that means PTR can hold one address. So what will be the memory representation? I can have a num here, right? A num is having a value 50. And then we have PTR. PTR is basically ampersand num, and let us assume this is the memory location 1000. And as you know, that ampersand num is again equal to 50, right? So basically star and ampersand cancel out each other, just like multiply and division, right? Star and ampersand cancel out each other. Now there is a concept in C which is known as the concept of double pointers. So what happens in double pointers? So in double pointer is something integer 2 star, right? So hence a double pointer. And then let's say we say ptr2 is equal to ampersand ptr, right? So what happens when I have a double pointer here? So basically I am referring the location of a location. So let us first see an example that will actually make us clear. So this is a very simple example. So see, we are having num is equal to 123, fine. And then we are having a normal pointer, integer star ptr1. And then we are having a double pointer, integer star star ptr2, right? So see, whenever you come across pointer arithmetic, the best manner is to, you know, make the boxes and the diagrams. So things will be very, very clear to you, right? So just let me show you how will I make boxes, right? So in the sense, quiz or NSEMs, you have multiple choice questions, and many times during interviews also such kind of questions are asked. So now I will show you how do actually you proceed with such questions, right? So let me just do a next here. Let me place the question on this side and the board on this side. Let me just hide the menu. Hide menu. And this. I hope it is better visible. Okay. So now in such a case, what do you do is like you start with your first line. It says integer num is equal to 1, 2, 3. So what I will do, I will make a num here, right? And assign the value of num as 123. Right? So the moment basically you do this, let me just unzoom this to make it full screen. And pen color, let me keep black. So the moment you declare an integer, right, along with it, write the address also. So what is the address? You represent address by ampersand num, right? And in this case, I am assuming it to be 300, right? I am taking 300 so that we can map our outputs also, right? And along with this, we also know that if I want to access the content of a memory location, this again will be 123, right? So whenever you declare an integer, along with it, write these three values also, right? So num basically is 123. Address of num in some memory location will be 300 or any random value. In our case, it is like 64223300. So I have taken it 300. And just write star ampersand num, because we know star and ampersand cancel out each other, right? So now what I'm having, I am having integer star ptr, right? So I know that star ptr means star basically means address. So ptr1 will hold some address. Similarly, double star ptr2. So this I have written the comment, this pointer ptr2 is a double pointer. This basically is ptr1, right? So now just let us see, we have an integer pointer. So that means ptr1 will contain an address. On that address, an integer is stored. That's the meaning of it. So just let us move forward. So the moment I declare ptr1, so let us assume there is some memory location which is known as ptr1. And we just draw a small box for it. Similarly, we have integer ptr2. So just let us draw another box for it. So pen color, let me keep it uniform. And then we have ptr2 and a small box, right? Of course, these all will also have a particular memory location. So now let me just keep it for your reference. I am making this diagram so that you can get the concept very easily. You know, once you make these boxes, things really become very simple. But if you don't keep these boxes, then it is always tricky, right? You get confused and all. This is for PTR2. So right now we do not know what is the value. Why? Because if you see, these are just undefined, right? We have not initialized them to anything. So I'm keeping it blank boxes, right? And now again, let me check for this color. So just star ampersand PTR1 is equal to this. And star ampersand PTR2 is equal to this, right? Something will be placed here. Now let us see what is the program saying. The program says that PTR1, right? The program says that PTR1 is equal to ampersand of num. Now what was num? Num basically was 123. So ampersand of num will be address of num. A for ampersand, A for address. So now in our case, what is ampersand of num? Now ampersand of num is 300. So definitely when we say PTR1 is equal to ampersand of 1, so what we do, we just change our pen color. Let us assign something green here. I hope it is visible. So now when we say PTR1 is equal to ampersand of num, right? So what is ampersand of num? Ampersand of num you can obtain from here, which is equal to 300. That means PTR1 is equal to 300. That means PTR1 is equal to 300, right? And similarly, we know star ampersand PTR1. So whenever star ampersand PTR1 is there, you can actually assume it to be PTR1, right? So again, I can fill up this particular value. Fine, I hope this is clear this till this point, right? Now what I'm saying, PTR2 is equal to ampersand of PTR1. Now if you see, PTR1 contains 300. And there is something which that needs to be stored at this particular address. Again, on your execution, the addresses will be different. But in our case, right, in our case, the let me see. The address ampersand PTR1 is basically 296. I am just using the last three digits for easy access. Right. So see, PTR1 is basically 300 and ampersand PTR1 is 296. So in our case, ampersand PTR1 basically is 296. So let me just keep it black and keep it 296. Right. So I'm keeping 296 because the program executed like this and gave ampersand PTR1 as 296. Now what we are doing, we are saying that PTR2 is equal to ampersand of PTR1. Right. So let me just write. So it's saying PTR2 is equal to ampersand of PTR1. Right. Now, what is ampersand of PTR1? Right, it is 296. Fine. So basically, that implies PTR2 will be is equal to 296. So what is PTR2 that I will keep in this particular box? Let me change the pen color. So PTR2 is 296. Right. And again, I can just say the same thing. Star ampersand PTR2 is same as PTR2. So what will I do? I will make it 296. Again, this PTR basically has a value, so it must be stored in some memory location. Let us just check the memory location. See what I did here, printf PTR2 address is ampersand PTR2. In our case, we got the value 292. So I will keep this as, just let me change the pen color to black. So I will keep this as 292. So you may be wondering how the addresses are assigned. So what happens in address assignment? As you know, integer takes 4 bytes in the memory. Again, yesterday some students asked me some good questions because when they were incrementing long double, in some cases it was getting incremented by 16 bytes, right? So all these things are processor and architecture specific. So if any question comes in the quiz or NSEM, I will explicitly mention that the size of the integer is 4 bytes. So determine the next address. So you need to add it by 4. If I say the size of long is basically 8 bytes, right? Or long double is 12 bytes. So it will depend on that particular thing. Okay. So now if you can see the address, you know, when I'm printing all the address, see, I'm printing the address of num. I'm printing the address of PTR1 and PTR2. So can you see the address of num is 300? The first 4 digits are same. Then the next is 296 and the next is 292. So what happens if you see these are stored in consecutive memory locations, right? Because what happens, we have 3 variables, ampersand num, which is having an address 300, ampersand PTR1, which is having an address 296, and ampersand PTR2, which is having an address of 292. Now, why does the compiler do like this? Because, you know, accessing memory locations which are in consecutive locations to one another is very easy and it is very efficient, right? You can, like, for example, array. Array are stored in consecutive memory location. So the moment you say A of 10, you can immediately access A of 10 in one shot, right? Similar to this, this happens. For example, had these been a character array, right? Assume, right, these were character array. So what the compiler would have done, 300, 299, 298. Had this been long double, right? Assuming it to be 12 bytes, so this would have been 300, 288, and then 276. In this fashion it goes. On some older compilers, it may happen that some random assignment may happen, but the recent compilers basically assign consecutive memory locations. So in some compiler, the cases is increasing, right? 300, 304, 308. In other cases, it is decreasing. Most of the time, it is decreasing, right? So now let us predict the output, right? So this map is now prepared. So our program has various kinds of outputs, right? So that output is displayed on the screen also, but let us now try to debug what is the output, right? So once you have made this memory map, things become really cool. So let me just adjust this window, bring this to some point here. Okay, cool. So now what I'm asking here, I'm asking the value of num, which is nothing but the variable num. So now if you see this particular figure, num is nothing but this particular element, right? So the value of num will be 123. Now let us check the output. So value of num is 123. So we have got it right. So now value of num method 2 is, so any value you can also access using star and ampersand. So this will again be the same. So we have already written star ampersand num is 123. So again using method 2 you are getting 123. Now value of num using pointer 1, right? Now I want to access this particular value 123 using pointer 1, right? So what I'm writing here, star ptr1. So now let us see what is star ptr1, right? So what is star ptr1? How do you access it? So what was ptr1? Ptr1 was 300. So replacing ptr1 with 300, see ptr1 was an address. The content of the address is 300. So what does star 300 means? As we have already discussed, star means content. Right? So that means content at address 300. Now what is the content at address 300? The content at address 300, see these are all addresses. These are all address. Right? These are all address. So what is the content at address 300? The content at address 300 is 123. Right? We have already seen this yesterday. So just once again, value of num ptr1 is star ptr1. So what we know, ptr1, we actually know that it is 300. So what is star ptr? Star ptr means content at the address 300. So what is the content at address 300? Which is 123. Right? So basically this again prints us 123. Now it is saying value of num using ptr2. Now remember, ptr2 was a double pointer. Now if you see here the declaration, ptr1 was ampersand num, right? If we do a simple mathematics of expansion, ptr2 is equal to ampersand ptr1, right? And now what was ptr1? Ptr1 was ampersand num. So now if you can see, I can actually replace this by ampersand num, because ptr1 was assigned to ampersand num. So now you can see that ptr is containing an address to another address, right? Because we have two ampersand. So it can be read like this. So num will be stored at some memory location. In our case, it is 300. Then that 300 is also stored at another location. So this 300 is stored at location 296. So basically ptr2 contains 296. So initially this concept gets a bit trickier to understand, but once you make these boxes, it is really very easy to understand. Now you understand why when we declare star star ptr2, you can actually see that ptr2 actually contains 2 ampersand, right? So let's say if I am having something of a, because this pointers can be extended to anything. So let's say I have 5 pointers, star star star, right? So somewhere down the line internally, PTR5 would be having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and some PTRX, right? Something of this sort. So this is how double, triple, nth pointer works, right? So let me just erase this for now. Now again, back to this example. So value of num using PTR2, and you can see there is a zigzag pattern here, right? So you can see that 300 is basically, which is the address of num, is this pointer. 296 is again a, so address of a particular pointer is basically the value of the next pointer. So you can see PTR1 is having 300 and is stored at the location 296, right? But 296 is basically the value of PTR2, right? So what happens here, let us again do this double pointer thing. What happens when you have star star PTR2? Now let me expand this using this particular example. So what is star star PTR2, right? So we will again explain this using this particular thing, star star PTR2, right? So what is the value of PTR2? The PTR2 basically is 296. So what did this mean? It is having star star 296, 296, fine. So whenever we are having star 296, what does this mean? Content at address 296, right? So this star is remaining. Basically, we are expanding this star. So content at address 296. So see, this is the address. Our last row is all address. So what is the content at 296? The content at address 296 is 300. So this bracket basically expands to 300, right? Now again, I have a star. That means content at address 300. So what is address 300? Address 300 is here. Content at 300 is 123, right? So this basically expands to 123 and the expression is solved. So as you see, once you make all these boxes, you know, things becomes very easy, right? So basically, and hence star star PTR2 basically again led you to 123. So now you can see when I'm having a num variable 123, I can actually use four methods to basically access. Star ampersand num, the standard method, no worries about it. Then we have star PTR1 and double pointer PTR2. Fine, this is done. Now again, I'm having this address of num. So a standard way of finding address of any variable is just attach ampersand to it, ampersand num. So in this case, we are getting 300, right? Ampersand num, as we know, is 300. Now what I'm saying, address of num using pointer one. Right, using pointer one. So how do we see that? We already know that we have equal PTR1 is equal to ampersand num. So what we do, we just replace this ampersand num with PTR1. Again, we can verify what is ampersand num. Ampersand num is 300. Locate in this box where is 300 coming. So you can access by two methods. You can say by PTR1, which is again 300, which is I am doing here. Or you can also access, let me just come back here. You can again say this is content at address this. Again, it will yield the same output. Okay, basically there is an enter here. So it is giving an error. Let me just run the code. Okay, fine. So again, two ways. So now address of num using PTR2. So what I'm now doing, I am saying asterisk PTR2, right? So what will asterisk PTR2? How will it will give me? Let me just change asterisk PTR2. Let us expand. What is PTR2? PTR2 basically is 296. So content at address 296. So what is address 296? Address 296 is this. What is the content at this, which is 300, which is nothing but the address of num, right? So different methods. So once you draw these boxes, everything in pointer becomes super easy. Now again, the value of pointer. So let me just expand this a bit so that everything comes in a single line. So now value of pointer PTR1, it is saying value of PTR1. What is the value of PTR1? You can see the box where PTR1 is written is 300. So you can see value of PTR1 is again 300. Now it is saying value of PTR1 using another method. What is the another method? Star ampersand PTR1. Again, same thing, because star and ampersand cancel each other. What remains? PTR1. PTR1 is same as PTR1. So you get 300. Now value of pointer PTR1 via PTR2, right? What is the value of PTR1? PTR1 is value 300. Now if I want the value of 300 via pointer 2, see now, how do you see that? So we know that PTR2 is 296, right? And the value at address 296 is 300. So what will I do? I will just do an asterisk PTR2, right? And the explanation is here itself. Asterisk PTR2 means PTR2 is 296. Star 296 is value at 296, which is 300. So guys, with pointers, you need to do a little bit of practice. Make this diagram by your own hand and then try to understand the arithmetic. It is not that difficult, but if you just observe it, it may seem a bit tricky, right? Coming to the last part, value of pointer PTR2 using PTR2, right? So what is PTR2 here? PTR2 is 296. And again, another method is just star ampersand, which basically cancels out each other. So this is how basically you do anything which is related to pointers, right? So I just wanted to introduce you to a double pointer stuff, right? I can actually go till triple pointer, but usually double pointers are more than enough for C programming. So this is how pointer manipulation is done. So any doubts till now can be asked, and then we proceed to a 5-minute break. Right? Hope the Dropbox is synced. So let's have a break for 5 minutes, guys. We meet at 11:02.
Sir, regarding yesterday's program, in the const, when we declare a variable as constant, will you take any default value, or is it really necessary that we should initialize with some value?
Okay, I didn't get the question. Can you please repeat? So in the value of const, default value means?
Like, for example, like, does it take a garbage value, or will it give an error if we do not provide any default value? Like, for example, if const 5 was declared, and if I don't initialize it to 3.14 and just leave it as 5.
Okay, so in such cases, it is, you know, better to just execute and see. Because you know some behaviors are a bit compiler specific. So let me just try to find out the code again. Pi. Okay, great. So let us do one thing. I just remove this particular value and let me just comment this because constant pi. Let us see whether it assigns a value 0. So see, by default, the compiler assigns a value of 0. Right. So basically, you know, when we did our BTEC 2005 to 2009. At that time, the version of compiler used to assign a garbage value if you declare something of undeclared, basically without assigning a default value. But as and when the compiler started, you know, updating, so basically you see that these compilers basically assign a value 0. I think even if I do this int here, this int will assign a value 0. Let us just execute and see. See the just a minute. Should not have been the case. Oh, I did percent f, hence it came as 0000. See, as you see in this particular case, it is assigning a random value in case of int, right? 41944432. But when I basically did it float, it basically was assigning the value 0. So it's a compiler specific. So the correct answer to your question is, if you don't initialize const, the default value will be a garbage value, right? Or you can say it is compiler specific. Compiler specific is the most appropriate answer, right?
Okay, sir.
Sir,
Yes.
when we pass array as a parameter to any function,
Correct.
its base address gets passed.
Correct.
But sir, when you taught us functions, we were passing array, and argument of that function was int array. Then whole array was getting passed int.
Correct. So basically, internally, what happens, even if you pass an array to a function, every time only the base address is passed, right? Irrespective of any declaration, even if you specify the size of it, only the base address is passed. Because see, why this happens, you know? I will just explain you the concept. Let me just show the menu here. Next, add hide menu. See, let's say you have a function which is known as sum, right? And sum takes three parameters, integer x, integer y, and integer z, right? And let's say you just do basically, you return x plus y plus z, fine? So now what happens? You explicitly need to pass all the three variables, right? Because they may be stored at some locations in the memory. X may be here, y may be here, and z may be here. Right? There is a possibility that there may be not in continuous memory location. In computer science, we say contiguous, G-U-O-U-S. Contiguous means one after the other. But when you have an array, let's say you have an array of five numbers. Let us keep it random. 12, 77, 1, minus 2, and 4. So let's say you are passing a sum function and you are passing the array of it. Array, and let's say you are sized of the size of array is 5, right? So what happens when you do void sum and you take int array and let's say int size, right? So technically I could have also passed a sum array having array of 0, array of 1 up to, let me just move this chat window here. I missed out the screen. So let me again write. I could have actually passed like this: array of 0, array of 1, up to array of 4. Why 4? Because the index is 5, right? This would have also worked. But you know, there is no use of passing in such a manner. Why? Because in the memory, I know whenever I am declaring an array, right, this is the base address, which is 2000, let's say, right? And this is our array. What are the elements here? We have 12, 77, 1, minus 2, and 4. Now that we know, array has two properties. Like for example, when I'm declaring this as an integer array, all the array elements have to be integers, right? It cannot have float or character. It is basically a collection of similar data types, right? And now that we know that it's an integer array, an integer takes basically 4 bytes in the memory. So the moment I pass this kind of expression, so what I am passing in this expression, I am basically passing the address, which is nothing but 2000. Let me just change the pen color to blue. So when I am passing array, I am basically passing 2000 to the function. So the function has 2000 in it. So now the sum function basically knows that I have the base address 2000, and also it knows that the base address corresponds to type of int. So what it does, whenever it is accessing the array, it knows that my base address is 2000 plus int. So what does it do? For the next element, it does 2000 plus 4, which is 2004. For the next location, 2004 plus 4. So it keeps on adding in this particular fashion. Remember, you can also pass all the elements of the array individually, but that makes no sense. Let's say you have an array of 100. You won't pass 100 elements to the array. So I think your doubt gets cleared, or you still have doubts?
No, sir, it's clear.
It's clear, right? So hence, whenever you are passing an array, remember, arrays are always passed by reference, right? Even if you just specify the name of the array, whether you pass array like this or you pass array like this, implicitly, it is always passed using a reference, right? So whenever you make changes to the array, the changes to the array in the main will also get reflected automatically, right? So just 2 minutes, I will be back. Okay guys, welcome back. So we have, let me just reopen the folder. June 2. Yeah. Okay, so this is a very small program. So this hash defined size 20, basically it's known as a preprocessor directive. So we will explain this later, but basically you can just assume it's a simple declaration. Like, so let's say I'm defining float array size, right? So when I declare it like a hash defined size 20, it helps actually the programmer to change the value quickly, right? So there is a general concept where you keep all the functions at the beginning and you keep the int main at the last. Right now, what happens is, like, for example, if your code is, let's say, 5 or 6,000 lines, and then to change the size of the array, it is tedious to locate, right? Locate the main and then change the variable. So a very efficient and a very quick method to do that is you just define using hash defined size 20, right? And just let us execute this code and see what it does is, right? So basically the number of bytes in the array, right? So what is the size of the array? The size of the array is 20 and it's a float array. So obviously the total size occupied with this array will be 20. That is the size of the array into the size of float, which is 4, right? Now just see one thing. What I'm doing here is I am writing the size of array, which we have already seen yesterday. Size of array, basically what would be the size of array? What is the float size? Is 4, and size of array basically is 20. So 20 into 4, 80 bytes. And see, I am passing a function. I am passing the array to a function known as getSize, right? Now what I am doing, whenever I am passing the array, I am passing the base address, right? Let's say 2000 I am passing here and collecting this as a pointer. And now I am returning the size of pointer. Why did I did this program? The recent doubt which I cleared here is, so in this case, you can see the number of bytes returned by getSize, right? So as you know, this particular array, let me just take this particular example again. Okay, let me just do a next sheet. Next, add menu. So here what I'm doing is, I am having an array which is of float, and this is size, right? This size is defined as 20. Float takes 4 bytes, right? So total space will be 20 into 4 is equal to 80 bytes, right? So this is how you compare the total space taken by any variable, right? So basically it is equal to n into k, where n is the size and k is the bytes of individual data type. So if your size is 50 and the individual data size is, let's say, 12, so the total will be 600 bytes. Now see what happens here. I am passing this get size. I am having this array passed in the get size function. What is the get size function doing? Because it is getting the base address of that array, right? So now assume that array has just three elements, 1.1, 1.2 and 5. So what is the base address? In the memory, it will be stored as 1.1, 1.2 and 5. The base address, let's say, is 2000, right? So basically when I'm passing this array internally here, 2000 is passed, right? Which is nothing but the address of the base element. And when I'm doing size of PTR, basically what I'm doing, I am doing the size of 2000, right? So usually in the memory representation, the size is taken as 4. Basically, it's a 32-bit memory representation. This again is compiler specific. Even I do not understand why on this particular case, my computer is a 64-bit architecture. So it basically should have returned 8. Because for 64-bit is nothing but 8 bytes, right? So let me just try to execute this program on an online GDB compiler. And let us see what the output is given here. See, in this case of online compiler, the number of bytes returned by get size is 8, right? Probably my GCC version, that is MinGW, is 32-bit variant, hence it is giving a size of 4. On most of your machine, it should return a size of 8. Why? Because on a 64-bit architecture, right? 64-bit means 64-bit processor, 64-bit memory management operation by the operating system. And you can check this out here also. In my computer, like you can just go here on your my computer, right click, do properties. Here you will see in this particular fashion. Yeah, see, 64-bit operating system and x64-bit processor, right? That means a 64-bit processor. So 64-bit is nothing but 8 bytes, right? Because 8 bits is 1 byte. So divide by 8 is this. So in your case, if it is coming as 32-bit operating system, then basically it will have the size of 4. That does in my case. But what happens, see, on a 64-bit architecture, you can actually install a 32-bit program, right? You cannot have a 64-bit program on a 32-bit microprocessor. So if I show you an example, I can actually search like this, you know, VLC 32-bit, right? So basically we have a 32-bit version and we also have a 64-bit version. So on 64-bit version, you can install a 32-bit. So on the higher version, you can install a lower variant. Fine. Just like, you know, you can have a ticket, right, which is of a higher variant. Let's say you buy a business class air flight ticket and there is a seat which is empty in economy. You can always go and sit there. But the reverse is not true. Fine. So that is why it is coming. So the point of this program was telling that when you pass the array, right, only the base address is passed and not the entire array, right? So this was just a small program. So let me just quickly go through the other programs. Okay, now how do you access array, right? So again, I have an array here, array of size 4, right? So we have 4 elements in the array. I'm defining hash array as 4. So now there are 4 methods to access the array elements. Let me just output this code directly. So you can see array index notation 10, 20, 30, 40, 10, 20. All the outputs are same, but there are 4 methods by which you can access arrays. The first is a standard method that you have been using throughout. I equal to 0, I less than size of array. In our case, it is 4. And I plus plus or plus plus I. So what you're doing, this notation basically is known as array index notation. You specify the name of the array and then you specify the notation. Fine. What is the second method? Second method is basically known as the offset method. Now, let me explain you what does offset actually mean. Show menu. Next page. So let's say you have an array B in this particular case. Let me draw the diagram here. So this is 10, 20, 30, 40. So what happens here? Let's say the base address is 2000. Now, if I know the base address and I know that this is an integer array, right? You can see integer array and you can see I'm defining a pointer which is passing the, which is having the base address. B basically is basically nothing but the base address of the array. So in our case, base pointer is equal to 2000, or we can write this also as B PTR. Guys, just a second. हाँ अजय भाई नमस्ते कैसे हो. थैंक यू अजय. अच्छा 9678 336 348 9678 33. हाँ सही है. मयंक अग्रवाल B2604. क्या हुआ पैसे का किसके रिगार्डिंग? अभी वैसे मेरा लेक्चर चल रहा है तो मैं आपसे बात करता हूँ बाद में. ठीक है. हाँ ओह सॉरी गाइस, समवन वाज एट द डोर. सो व्हाट डू आई मीन बाय ऑफसेट इज, सो दिस बेसिकली इज इंडेक्स 0, इंडेक्स 1, इंडेक्स 2 एंड इंडेक्स 3. सो दीज आर नोन एज बेसिकली ऑफसेट्स, right? So basically, if I want to access B of 0, that is the base address, I can see the address 2000. But now after this, I want to access, I can just increment it by the size of the size of the data type. So in this case, just a minute, we have integer array. So what I can do, I can either access this by increasing the offset by 1, then again increasing this by offset by 1, which makes it 2. Again increasing the offset, making it 3. Or I can have the base address and increasing it by 4. Then this becomes 2004, then 8, and then 12. So this will be 2004, 2008, and 2012. So now just let us see the pointer offset notation. So see what I'm doing here. I'm defining offset as 0, right? Offset less than array size, which is 4, and plus plus offset. So what happens here in this particular case, offset also goes like I. But just see the notation how we are representing. B basically is the base address of the array plus offset. If you remember yesterday in pointer arithmetic, when we were doing PTR++, so PTR++ was getting increased by an amount of the data type. If it was an integer, it was increasing by 4. If it was a long double, it was increasing by 12. So here what will happen when I write B plus offset? So B basically has 2000. So B plus offset, right? So in the first case, offset will be having a value 0. So it will be B plus 0, which is equal to 2000. And then what we are doing, star of 2000. That means content at location 2000, which is nothing but 10. In the next case, we will have B plus offset, that will become 1. So now what is B? B is an integer array. It's having the value 2000. When I do 1, this is pointer arithmetic. So it will increase by the size of the data type, which is integer. So this will be 2000 plus 4, which is equal to 2004. And when I do content at 2004, it basically will point to this particular location, which is the next location, and it will print 20. Right? So this is another way of representation, star B plus 0. And then we have a pointer index notation. This is same as the array notation. See, base pointer, what was BPTR? BPTR was nothing but basically B, right? So you can see, since BPTR is equal to B, if I replace this, it actually becomes the index notation, right? So again, just another method. And finally, we can also do, because B, you can see in this B plus offset, and B is nothing but BPTR. So just four methods of accessing array elements. So at times it is up to the programmer's convenience. Mostly to what I have seen, people use the same address based notations. But in case of strings, at times you need to use these particular location, these particular access methods. Fine. So in the 13th program, okay. So basically I think we are beginning with strings here. So I think strings we will take from tomorrow. So I think that's it for today's class. So we are wrapping up 5 minutes early. So just guys, please go through this particular code. I mean, I have also kept an image here for double pointers, right? So I is having a value 5 stored at location 1000. PTR1. So what is PTR1? PTR1 basically is ampersand of I. So location of I was 1000. So ampersand of I became 1000, right? So what is PTR1 is ampersand of I. So this goes stored here. Now PTR1 is, let's say, stored at memory location 2000. PTR2, it says, is ampersand PTR1. So ampersand PTR1 basically becomes like this. So phi, you can see this particular snake ladder kind of. Phi stored at location 1000. Location 1000 is stored as a value of PTR1. PTR1 is stored at location 2000, which is nothing but the value of PTR2. Right? So just go through this particular example. Next week, mostly, we will have a quiz on pointers, pointer arithmetic. It will be a simple quiz, I think 20 questions only, right? So please go through the pointer programs. Strings, we will begin tomorrow, guys. So that's it for the class. Again, the pattern will be same like midsem, all MCQs only, fine? So that's it for today, class. Thank you.
Has left the meeting.